I'm the rest is Latin America, so.
Yeah, yeah. I grew up in the semi geek south, the Latin American geek south.
Let's begin, and I'm sure that some other people will trickle in as we begin the charla. So this is the charla today, Latin American cinema, the historical, the comparative history. Today it's going to be presented by Professor Paul Schroeder Rodriguez. He's a professor at Amherst College. And I had the pleasure of meeting him last semester, at the end of the semester. Contacted us because he was new, us, me, my husband, and myself. And we went and met him. That day I asked him if he wanted to do a charla for us, and he agreed, and we are very happy that he's here today. So I'm going to introduce him. He says, growing up in Puerto Rico in a bilingual bicultural home marked Professor Schroeder Rodriguez's academic trajectory in many ways. From his chosen field of study, Latin American literatures and cultures, to how he studies these literatures and cultures comparatively as part and parcel of global flows of ideas, values, and styles. He teaches a wide range of courses using a variety of approaches. He states that regardless of the course, his goal in the classroom is to better understand ourselves and one another through the vicarious experiences afforded by the narrative study. Professor Schroeder Rodriguez's research focuses on Latin America cinema, and his contribution to the field include a book on Cuban foremost film director Tomás Gutiérrez Alea, and the first comprehensive history of Latin American narrative cinema. He began to research Latin American cinema as a graduate student at what has sustained his interest over the years in cinema. Cinema's unique ability to engage us emotionally and intellectually, and its versatility as a tool to better understand a region as culturally and geographically diverse as Latin America. He's also in the beginning stages of a new research project that seeks to answer why Latin America in the 18th century saw the emergence of an alternative discourse of modernity that combined Baroque ideas of reciprocity and faith with Enlightenment ideals of individual freedom and scientific knowledge. So Paul Schroeder Rodriguez, Latin American Cinema, A Comparative History, which is the title of the book, is the first to address all the major periods in the region from the silent era to the digital age.
Thank you. Gracias, Gloria. Thank you, Gloria, for inviting me. It's a pleasure being here today. What I will do is talk about generally what the project of the book is, and then focus on one film that I discussed towards the end of the book. If I sit down, I wonder if everybody can see me.
Yeah.
So what the title says, comparative history, what I mean by that is that Latin America, typically comparative literature means you study literatures in different languages. So maybe the Italian literary tradition compared to, say, German. In Latin America, there are at least two major languages, Spanish and Portuguese, so that's part of why it's called comparative history. But it's also comparative in the sense that even, say, if you want to study Argentinian cinema and Mexican cinema, even though Spanish is the dominant language in both countries, it is still the case of two very different cinematic trajectories, because these are two very different countries with different histories and cultures. So that's what that subtitle means.
Uh,
And I decided I needed to look at cinema in Latin America. I didn't want to do like a lot of the studies do that say, for example, it looks at silent cinema and then it goes down the list by country, Argentina, Brazil, etc. I wanted to see what were the dialogues and flows of information and aesthetics at every major period. So that's where triangulation comes in, is the idea that I will be looking at, or I looked at how filmmakers, let's say they were in Mexico, they were thinking of, okay, what is happening here in Mexico in terms of cinematic production, aesthetically, ideologically, etc. What is happening in the rest of Latin America? What is happening in Europe, which is a major referent in European cinema? And what is happening in Hollywood, the third major reference. So Latin America, Europe, and Hollywood. Because I argue that filmmakers have to calibrate their projects by taking into account, for example, audience expectations, which were modeled by Hollywood, aesthetic aspirations, which were generally taken from Europe, and then the local tradition of the viewers in Latin America. The other part of the theoretical framework is multiple modernities. And this came up towards halfway through the project where I realized that I wanted to see the question that led the research was, how is modernity represented in Latin American cinema for Latin American audiences? But then I realized that there isn't one modernity that is represented, there's several modernities. And in cinema itself, I noticed that there are three major discourses of modernity represented: liberalism, socialism, and corporatism. Those are the major three, and then there's a fourth one that I call neo-baroque, that is really an alternative discourse of modernity. So for example, in the silent period, liberal discourse is hegemonic. If you see silent films, it's mostly projecting a liberal discourse of modernity. Then in the studio era, for historical reasons that I could get into during the Q&A, there's a shift towards corporate discourses of modernity. And then after the Cuban Revolution, there's a shift in Latin American cinema towards representing socialist discourses of modernity, or a socialist discourse of modernity. So these are the five periods I cover in the book. The third one is mostly the 50s. The fourth period is the 60s, 70s, and 80s, into the early 80s, and contemporary cinema is the 90s until today. And I want to focus on contemporary cinema today. That section of the book is divided into two chapters. Chapter 9 talks about how in the mid-90s, right after the collapse of the Berlin Wall, the spread of neoliberalism, a lot of governments in Latin America decide, as part of neoliberal policies, decided to cut funding for filmmaking, state funding. So the three major industries, Brazil, Argentina, and Mexico, collapsed, like from 1 year to the next. The rest of that decade, the 90s, was a period of recovering from that collapse by filmmakers who said, okay, this is a new reality, let's look for financing elsewhere, mostly private capital. Let's use the new technologies that are available now, digital, towards the end of the decade, that are a lot cheaper. And then towards the end of the decade, there was also a return to some forms of subsidy from the state. And chapter 10, which is Latin American cinema in the 21st century, which is where we are still conceptually, you know, the films that are made starting in around 2000, 2001, they look a lot still like what you see today if you go to watch a film from Latin America. So I'll focus on that chapter. That chapter I divide into two parts. I noticed that the first decade of the new century is characterized by a lot of films where suspense is the narrative strategy, and I theorize that, I try to theorize it as a reflection of precarious times. And I also talk about the rise of the women director, which is an incredible phenomenon, because during the 20th century, if there were any, or there's always been female directors, but they hardly ever enter the canon. There has never been a critical mass, really, of women filmmakers. And in the 21st century, there is definitely a critical mass of women filmmakers. They are winning, you know, all the major prizes. So I discuss the reasons for that. So today I'll talk about a film made by a female director, Emil Cassaro. And I'll talk about how in the film there's competing memories of Latin America's violent past. And what I decided to do for this part is to read from the text, so you get an idea also of the text. La Teta Asustada, which was directed by Claudia Llosa from Peru. It was a co-production between Peru and Spain. It was released in 2009. Is Peru's most awarded film of all time. It won, among many other prizes, Best Film Awards at the Berlin, Havana, Lima, Guadalajara, and Bogota film festivals. Like Lucrecia Martel's trilogy, which is the other example I discuss at length in this chapter. She's a director from Argentina. So like Martel's trilogy, The Milk of Sorrow explores the legacy of Latin America's violent past, but it does so from the perspective of an indigenous woman without any of the class or race privileges that Martel's heroines enjoy. The film begins by narrating rather than representing the violence that took place during Peru's civil war in the 1980s. In an opening sequence that features what sounds like a lullaby against a black background. So that's supposed to be black right now. That's how the film begins, and you hear the sounds of this lullaby. But as the song progresses, and as we continue to read the subtitles of the lyrics, which are in Quechua, we realize that it is not a lullaby. And just as the lyrics are about to take a violent turn, the black screen fades into a close-up of the singer, a very old indigenous woman. And she, as you can read from the subtitle, she talks about how she was raped during the Civil War. So, to the left is her daughter, who is the main character in the film. And this is the moment when the mother dies. So she dies right after singing that song. Or shortly thereafter, I'm sorry. So from the beginning of the film, it calls attention to rape as both an individual. Well, actually, I have the quote of what she sings, but it's too hard for me to read. But what she sings about is how she was raped individually, but all the women in the community were also raped. And what happened to her husband? From the beginning, the film calls attention to rape as both an individual and a collective experience. Individual, because it was this specific woman and her, I have to explain something here, which I skipped from the book, but her daughter was present in the womb, so the character on the left was a fetus in the mother's womb when the mother was raped. And the title of the film, La Teta Asustada, or The Milk of Sorrow, refers to this idea that the sorrow of the mother who was raped was transmitted to the child in utero, but also through the breast milk to her daughter. So by beginning in this way, the film calls attention to rape in this context as both an individual and a collective experience, right? It's transmitted, it's not just the mother, but also the daughter and the community. When Fausta's mother dies, Fausta faints and is taken to a public hospital. I should ask, how many people have seen this movie? Because I'm not retelling, so not everybody has seen it. Okay. So when the mother dies, Fausta, the daughter, is taken to a hospital where the staff learns that she keeps a potato inside her vagina. The doctor tries to convince Fausta's uncle of the need to remove the tuber, and is exasperated by the uncle's explanation that Fausta suffers from the milk of sorrow, which I just explained. And the idea actually comes from this book by Kimberly Tate Dunn. It was published originally in Spanish and shortly thereafter in English. She coined the term to, and I quote her, to convey how strong negative emotions can alter the body and how a mother could, via blood in utero or via breast milk, transmit this ease to her baby. Once home from the hospital, Fausta explains the function of the potato in a song to her dead mother. She sings, "My uncle doesn't understand, Mom. I saw it all from your belly. I felt the slashing of your belly. This is why now I wear this potato like a coat of arms, like a stopper. Because only revulsion stops revolting people." At this point, Fausta helps a group of women and also her transvestite cousin, I don't see very clearly, to embalm the dead mother in a what looks like a ceremony of mummification from pre-Columbian times. Unlike the ancient Incas, however, who mummified their dead for the afterlife, Fausta's aunt explains how she learned to do this for much more practical reasons, and I quote the aunt, "How could we prove their existence? We didn't have a picture or an ID card. We have no proof of being born, and much less of being killed." So having established the ethnic dimension of the mass rapes and killings in the country's recent history, the film proceeds to focus on Fausta's narrative trajectory of recovery from that trauma. And that, the film is really that, a narrative trajectory of recovery from that historical trauma. Fausta's aunt tells her of a domestic job at the mansion of a rich criolla woman, a white woman, but Fausta must be willing to go and return on her own, something she never does out of fear of being raped. Fausta accepts, but only because it is the only way she'll be able to pay for the transport of her mother's body back to the village in the Andes for a proper burial. Much of the rest of the film focuses on two relationships. The first one between that Fausta develops in her new job. The first one with the Aida, who is this woman on the left side of the still, played by Susie Sanchez, a Spaniard, and that's where the co-production comes in. She's the owner of the mansion and an acclaimed concert pianist who cannot find inspiration. So she's a Spaniard in real life. In the movie, she's Peruvian. In the movie, she's also a concert pianist who cannot find inspiration to write a new composition for her annual solo performance. So every year, she plays an original song. And the other relationship is with Noé, the gardener in the mansion, played by Efraín Solís, who, like Fausta, speaks both Spanish and Quechua. When Fausta first meets Aida, She's drilling a hole to put up a picture on her bedroom wall. Aida asks Fausta to hold the electric drill. I'm sorry you can't see that very well, but there we go. So she's drilling on the wall. And you see that picture on her left of a military person? So I'll talk about that. Thank you. But when Fausta sees that the picture on the left, she feels nauseous and runs to the kitchen, where she begins to sing in Quechua. Let's sing, we must sing pretty things to hide our fear, pretend it does not exist. Later, Aida asks Fausta to sing the song again. And when Fausta is unable to sing on demand, Aida offers her a deal. If you sing, I'll give you a pearl. If you complete the necklace, it's yours. In the end, Fausta keeps her end of her bargain. One could call it a Faustian bargain, right? And Aida uses her melodies as the basis for her new piano composition. However, Aida does not keep her end of the bargain, in part because she never tells Fausta that she's using the melody that is Fausta's. So on their way back from the concert, they're both in the same car. When Fausta comments on how well the concert was received, Aida is not pleased. She interprets the comment as a, because she interprets it as a double threat. One, to her position as the servant's master, because Fausta spoke without being asked. And two, to her reputation as a composer, because like I said, Aida never acknowledged Fausta's contribution to her composition. Thus threatened, Aida tells her son, who's driving, to stop the car, and very subtly but surely orders Fausta to get out right there in the middle of the city at night. Fausta's relationship with Noé is more horizontal, but complicated by the fact that he's a man. After establishing an uneasy mutual trust, they have a decisive, a symbolically rich conversation. If you could turn off the lights, please. Thank you. So Noé here is responding to a question that Fausta had asked earlier. This conversation seals the relationship between them as one of solidarity between equals. And so it is fitting that when Fausta, despite her fears, returns to the mansion one last time to claim the pearls that Aida owes her, it is Noé who finds her in a faint by the front gate. And Noé, the person she trusts to take her to the hospital to remove the potato from her vagina. With the potato and the fear it symbolizes finally removed from her body, Fausta is now able to complete her narrative trajectory of recovery. She uses the pearls to buy a truck, and on the way to the highlands, asks the driver to stop so that she can show her mother the Pacific Ocean, where, as a minor character had informed her earlier in the film, dead people can unburden their sufferings and wash away their sorrows. The film ends with a beautifully evocative image. Thank you. Having returned from the Andes, someone knocks at the door of the house where Fausta lives with her extended family. Nobody's there when she opens the door, but then she looks down and leans to enjoy the smell of the small white blossoms of a potato, or a potted potato plant that Noé has left for her. So as this narrative summary makes clear, the narrative does not center so much on the systematic rape of indigenous women per se, as on the ensuing trauma, and more specifically, on how the past could be remembered in ways that aid rather than hinder the victim's recovery. Broadly speaking, Fausta's traumatic memory evolves from something that thoroughly limits her, she can't walk by her own, on her own, to something she can overcome through resilience. Furthermore, because this trajectory is framed by a narrative conflict between Fausta and Aida, Fausta's individual trajectory bespeaks of a broader cultural conflict between two competing memories, and this is where the title of my talk comes from, two competing memories of Peru's past, a memory rooted in what Aníbal Quijano calls the private individual, which is aligned with the values of liberalism, and a memory rooted in indigenous practices of the private, of what he calls the private social, a term Quijano uses to refer to the kind of communal ownership and decision-making that combines a private that is not individual with a social that is not of the state. For instance, when Aida finds her childhood doll buried in the garden, her recollection of the story, I'll show you where that is. For those of you who've seen the film, so Aida on the left is watering the garden and there's a doll that is unearthed by the water. Thank you. So when this happens, her memory is hers only. It is not the kind of memory that is shared by other people of her generation or even by women of her social class. Instead, Aida's private individual memory reflects the class privileges that private property ownership can buy, including impunity of crimes that range from white-collar stealing, as when she appropriates Fausta's melody without compensating her, to the more heinous crimes of conquest and pillage that Aida's ancestors clearly practiced and which are symbolically represented in the film via the colonial artifacts and architecture of her mansion, as well as in the casting of her servants as either indigenous or Afro-Peruvians. By contrast, Fausta's memory is like the memory of Sebastian, this is something I discuss elsewhere in the book. It's that of a collective individual, meaning an individual who participates in the kind of private social ownership that defines Aijus. And so, Aijus are like a collective, it's a form of collective land ownership by extended families. It's from pre-Columbian times, and some forms have still survived, especially in the highest reaches of the Andes. And I argue that in the film, Fausta's family, the business of Fausta's family functions kind of like an IU, but in the city, in Lima. Because her family lives on a clearly demarcated plot of land of generous proportions, and every member of the family contributes to a wedding service business that functions like a family-run cooperative. So this IU-inspired social structure where ownership is both private and social, although not of the state, is therefore aligned with Fausta's own memory of rape, which is likewise a combination of experiences that are both private and social, although again, not of the state. This distinction between private individual and private social memories is analogous to the distinction that Maurice Halbwachs, the father of memory studies, makes between history and memory. History, he argues, and I quote, gives the impression that everything is transformed from one period to another, so that two successive periods are like two tree stumps that touch at their extremities, but do not form one plant because they are not otherwise connected. Society's collective memory, on the other hand, and I quote him again, is like a thread that is made from a series of fibers intertwined at regular intervals. Or rather, it resembles a cloth made from weaving these threads together. So the film actually has these complex ideas and represents them visually. For example, when Aida unearths the very doll and shares her private individual memory with Fausta, they stand next to each other like two tree stumps that touch at their extremities, but do not form one plant because they are not otherwise connected. By contrast, when Fausta's aunt explains why she learned to preserve the bodies of the dead, the explanation is like one of many threads of a collective memory. Each thread is distinct, yet they are interwoven into a recognizable pattern of systematic rape and murder. This idea is visually underscored through a carefully constructed mise-en-scène. Clearly discernible individuals are gathered all around the dead body of Fausta's mother, yet their hands and arms are all connected, like buried threads to the dead body and the living memory of the rape victim. Each of these two memories, Aida's Aida's private individual memory and Fausta's private social memory are in turn linked to two very different conceptions of time, one linear, the other cyclical. On the one hand, Aida is defined literally as the most recent member in a lineage of private individuals that decorates her bedroom wall, remember that? And her annual piano performance, as she says, will go on until she can no longer compose, at which time she will play a funerary march that will symbolically mark the end of a linear musical career. By contrast, Fausta's time is cyclical, like a plant's life cycle. Hence the fable-like symbolism of plants in the film, most notably in that final shot of the potato plant, where Fausta is identified with a blooming potato plant that represents both her final blossoming as an individual, right? But also the post-Civil War blossoming of an indigenous community that is embodied in Noé, whose choice of gift demonstrates that he now values the indigenous culture he once belittled. The subtle representation of this contested memory, of these contested memories, is at the heart of what makes the film exceptional beyond its clever use of suspense. And here I discussed there was a lot of discussion in the reception whether this was a good film or not, whether it was full of cliches or not. But I argue that, it's a clearly well-constructed film. And what I think makes it stand out is not so much that, although it makes for good viewing, but rather for how it positions spectators to readily identify with a protagonist, Fausta, whose rape is represented not merely symbolically, that's what the film underscores through all these symbols that I mentioned, but also as part of an actual system of social practices and cultural values that together foster and justify rape and other forms of collective torture and terror against women in general and against indigenous women in particular. In an article by Julianne Burton Carvajal titled Regarding Rape, she makes this distinction between representations in Latin American cinema of rape as symbolic or actual. And she analyzes a number of films, and she notices that there's this, I'll quote her, I'll paraphrase her. She notices an incremental, if unsteady, movement toward the alignment of spectatorial identification with a female subjectivity whose transformation is not simply symbolic. So what does this mean? That she notices that in Latin American cinema over the years, where there's been representations of rape, in the early 20th century, there was mostly just symbolic, meaning they were not central to the narrative, they were not explored in depth. They might be just a flashback or just added information, but not central to the central narrative trajectory. That's an example. And so this incremental movement toward our alignment with a character like Fausta, who suffered a rape not just as something symbolic in the narrative, but that remits viewers to an actual system of social practices, I argue, finds full expression in this movie for the first time in Latin American cinema. A film that paradoxically does not visually represent rape. Instead, the film effectively weaves narrative and memory threads that are both individual and collective in order to create a denser examination of rape, not just as an isolated act perpetrated by private individuals, but as part of an actual system of social practices and cultural values with historical, political, racial, ethnic, and gender dimensions that together foster and justify rape as a socially acceptable form of violence and repression. Significantly, as we have seen, I'll end with that, this view of rape necessitates an understanding of trauma as a social phenomenon that includes private individual memory, but that can never be reduced to it, because it is always already linked to past and ongoing struggles for social, ethnic, and gender justice. Thank you. And I'll be happy to entertain your questions.
I'll start, you know, since you mentioned that that was the first film that we call for the individual and make it part of the social. In other words, a rape is not real, not only symbolic, but also it's related to the ideology of Latin American film and the cultural. Is that the only movie that you mentioned was the first one? Have there any other movies subsequently appeared that focus on those particular issues?
There have been. I can't think of any off the top of my head. But maybe someone in the audience can think of one.
Any different question? Well, thanks for the great presentation. Actually, it made me feel like going by the book and read it. I was wondering at the beginning when you talk about the triangulation, if there are other references of world cinema, like, you know, on the one hand, for example, Bollywood or African cinema, other references besides that.
But the main ones are clearly Hollywood and Europe, Western Europe to be exact. Now there's some periods Sergei Eisenstein was in Mexico in the early 30s, 1930-31. His legacy on the subsequent Mexican cinema is strong, so here's an example of Eastern European cinema as also a referent. And in the 1960s, Glauber Rocha, who's the most important filmmaker from Brazil, incorporated some aesthetic elements from samurai films. These are clear in, most clearly in a film titled Deus of the Terra do Sol, which is translated into English as Black God, White Devil, but it's really God and the Devil in the Land of the Sun. And other cinemas that, you know, I'm sure there are influence, like there's a huge industry of film in Nigeria, and like you said, in Bollywood, in India. But I haven't come across any films that are in dialogue with those traditions, which does not mean that there aren't any.
No, thanks. The other question is about the stuff that, for example, Bob Stamp is problematizes the way in which Latin American cinema is characterized by trying to introduce, for instance, video popular and folk cinema, indigenous cinema, etc. If you are within that domain of a third kind of cinema, or if you are dialoguing with that, those other forms of filmmaking also.
I deliberately chose to focus on feature narrative cinema, because otherwise I would never finish writing a book. So I do not get into video filmmaking, but I could recommend some books that deal with that topic, some scholars whose focus is that. Auteur cinema is something I do tackle in the book, especially in the 1950s, where auteurism was one of the two main currents, and I argue that these two currents, one of them altruism, opened the way for new Latin American cinema. That new Latin American cinema did not emerge out of nothingness, like a lot of the historians tend to argue. There's work beforehand.
I thought about it in relation to Jose's first question, which is, I'm just curious to know what other findings in the chapter on, or the section of the chapter on the rise of women directors, if there's any other trends that you can identify as consequent to this entry of this critical mass into filmmaking, or, you know, clearly this is the sort of film that might be difficult to imagine being made by a man, not because of any essentialist characteristics, but because of kind of issues that it deals with, but are there other kinds of themes that you see emerging consequent to that rise?
I mean, the other director that I discuss at length as an example of women, the rise of women directors, is Lucrecia Martel from Argentina, and she's not alone in focusing on this topic of the relationship between desire, sexual desire, and power. This is, I see, as a recurrent theme, not just in her films, but in films by a lot of women throughout Latin America.
Banco do Brasil had a curator doing, they did a catalog of women in film, I don't know if only Brazil or in Latin America. So, and I received that catalog, PDF, because they used One Kiss My Gloria Zaldúa that we translated for Revista Estudos Feministas, and I managed to mediate the copyright, so I received. But it's very interesting because there is a lot of discussion now of women directors and feminist, you know, feminist film directors also in Latin America. So, I mean, would you point anyone in Brazil? Because I haven't read yet the catalog, but in Brazil.
Yes, I mentioned a few here. I mean, got their names right. There's many more, but there's a film called Femenino Plural, directed by Vera de Figueiredo. Figueiredo, I'm sorry. Mar de Rosas by Ana Carolina, this is about the 70s. Hora de la Estrella, Susana Amaral. Gaijin, Tizuka Yamasaki, Carmen Miranda, Elena Solberg. So these are previous to this boom of women filmmakers, and then more recently, Tata Amaral, for example, Uncel, Estrellas. She's the only one I mentioned as an example. But there's so many, and the reason why this has happened is that before the 20th century, if you were a woman, wanted to study how to make films, there were very few schools, film schools in Latin America, so you would have to study abroad. In the 1990s, a lot of schools began. I mean, the emergence of film schools is a phenomenon that began in the 60s, but they were mostly male students. Very few women were students. I don't know if it's because they didn't apply or, I mean, it's a complex issue, right? But by the 1990s, a lot more schools were in existence, and
there was no money, so therefore women entered the profession. That's how it always happens.
It has to do with money. So in part, yes, you're right, but also that if you were a woman and wanted to study and there were few schools of cinema, you'd go to Europe or the US, which is a huge investment if you're in Latin America, and because of cultural reasons, males would get this privilege, not women. So it's a combination of being able to study cinema in their own cities, and also the new reality that it's a lot less expensive to make a film nowadays. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And there's a third factor that I think is important in cases like Lucrecia Martel. It's also the rise of the female producer. Mm-hmm. So there's more female producers who are interested in producing films about women's issues. Mm-hmm. So all these comes together very nicely. There were some hands in the back, if I may.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. I'm not sure if you said that the environment of this film is Peruvian 1980s?
No, it's post-Civil War. So her mother, the old lady, suffered living through the Civil War. The family moved to Lima, so the daughter, Fausta, must be maybe 20 years old, something like that. So it's contemporary. 20-some years old, the film was released in 2009. Mm-hmm. Fausta is in her 20s, so it's contemporary.
Yeah, I was just wondering about this, if is there any shift in the way that Latin American cinema is dealing with political violence, in the sense that there was one epoch when political violence was in films, it was de frente, it was not just a contest, it
front
was
center,
yeah.
Yes.
And
mostly in the new Latin American cinema,
yeah,
in the 1960s, 70s.
And how would it be possible to understand why is this, if there is a shift where political violence is just a context and they're more personal, individual, or subjectivity plays as the main problem.
That is one of the main things that I note in contemporary cinema is this shift from what historians call the grand récit, the big history, mm-hmm. to the stories of individuals. It's a, why that happens is a complex question. Part in the case of cinema, I mean, it happens too in among academics, historians, right, this shift. But in the case of cinema, clearly there is a market preference for stories that center on individuals we can relate to with clear narrative trajectories, right? As opposed to going to a movie to be given a sermon about violence and history and what have you. So part of what contemporary directors are aware of is that they do not want to, that they want to reach an audience, and they look back at their previous generation that made great films but nobody watched. So they say, I'd rather have a film that is not as ambitious politically, ideologically, but that reaches an audience. So the historical and ideological aspects are in the background, like you said, and in the foreground is the story of an individual or a few individuals.
Okay, well, I can explain my other question. So this film really marks sort of a break and locks up a little bit for cinema from what you have said. So you think this is a dependency method and representation of the reality of the social.
Yes, it's not. This film is not atypical in that regard. Mm-hmm. It's not. It's not a tendency, it's what we have now mm-hmm. in Latin American cinema. Yeah, third cinema is like history books mm-hmm. to contemporary yeah. filmmakers 60s, and audiences. 60s, yes. Not to me, because I'm a historian of cinema. When I teach my classes, I always include plenty of films from the new Latin American cinema period.
No, yes, I wanted to mention before the there is another movie that kind of puts the rape also in the center, and it's also related to this new sensitivity. It's an Argentinian director that is also a woman. It's Lucia Puenzo. And is the movie is The Fish Child. And
yes,
it has
yes.
Actually many parallels, because also the woman is working as a servant in a house. She's indigenous, she speaks Guarani, and also has a relationship with the security guy that is also speaking Guarani with her. So there is these two levels.
And
she was raped by her father, so it's also the incest. Yeah.
And it also has a very nice combination of the symbolic
exactly.
with the actual.
Yeah.
Much more
yes.
clearly symbolic
yeah.
in Puenzo's film
yes.
than in Mateta's style.
Yes, because then the fish child is a legend that is related to the baby that is supposed to be living in the water.
And her recovery.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful film.
El Niño Pez.
El
Niño Pez.
And it's also from 2009, it's interesting, yeah. It's the same year.
I decided to focus on this one because it allowed me to talk about indigenous
yeah.
Realities, whereas I had talked, because when I discussed Martel, I discussed three of her films,
mm-hmm.
so I took up a lot of time talking of her films, which, by the way, are my favorite. So this is not one of my favorite films, but it allows me to speak of what I spoke of today. But contemporary filmmakers, I would say Lucrecia Martel is the best
mm-hmm.
from Latin America. And of her three films, I think her best one is called...
this one? Well, that's mine.
They're all very good. It's, very good. So it's a matter of opinion. In my case, I really like the last one.
The Headless Woman?
The Headless Woman. La mujer sin cabeza.
Literal translation.
No, it's true. With Martel, all the three translations are really true. Like the swamp is La Ciénaga, and the holy girl, La Niña Santa. So the three are
literal. Yes, that's They're all like titles from. She it's. In some way, she pays homage to the B films in the 1950s
mm-hmm.
in her titles, but also in the way she constructs sound and.
In this, in your analysis of the traditions and triangulation, how would you position the movie *El Abrazo de la Serpiente*? Have you seen, you know, the problem?
It's contemporary cinema. So,
yeah.
What happens, and what I mean by that is, one of the things that I do in the conclusion in the book is think, okay. You know, we're living in the middle of it right now, so it's hard to say clearly these are the characteristics of contemporary cinema. However, that said, I argue that one of the characteristics is that it has features from every previous period. So there's been like an accumulation
mm-hmm.
of aesthetics and themes
mm-hmm.
that make their way and that filmmakers today make use of.
Mm-hmm.
So some films are neorealist today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're looking back to neorealism of the 50s. Some are in dialogue with silent cinema. Some are in dialogue even with new Latin American cinema. A lot of them are in dialogue with classical cinema. And in the case of that film, I would say there's a combination of neorealism through the use of black and white film stuff,
mm-hmm.
right? And a very clearly linear narrative. But the theme itself is not something that neorealists ever
mm-hmm.
explore, right? The indigenous.
Yeah, and also an individual private, because the shaman is with a crisis of identity, and he cannot read anymore these rocks, and you know,
mm-hmm.
so it also deals with the Indian, like not being like.
And in some ways, you can think of Mexican films of the 1940s and 50s that. Looked at the indigenous subject, right? And maybe it's in dialogue with some of those
mm-hmm.
films too, like La Perla.
Mm-hmm.
Something to think about, but it's hard to say, you know, I would say we're still in this period that started in around 2000, 2001, and aesthetically and thematically, it's still clearly, the one distinction I make in the book, in the 21st century is that late 1990s to early 2000s, very early 2000s, films were kind of nostalgic in their tone. But then after 2001, after Argentina's Corralito and crisis all over Latin America because of neoliberalism, narratives deal much more with the present,
mm-hmm.
with the immediate present. And so suspense makes sense that they're using suspense because
mm-hmm.
suspense is a
mm-hmm.
narrative tool that highlights the present. You don't know, you're in the present, you don't know what's going to happen next, but you're
and
like.
And it highlights precarity.
And it
maybe
highlights
we'll come
the
to prevail in Hollywood
exactly.
too.
And that's the ideological
current moment.
Part of using suspense, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Thank you so
much.
Thank you for coming. Did you have the gas license?